Hello friends, welcome back to the tetrahedron chemistry classes. So guys, in today's class I am going to take the crystal field splitting in the non-octahedral fields. So though I have already covered the octahedral splitting in the octahedral field as well as splitting in the tetrahedral field, now I am going to move some different types of the geometries, right? And I'll explain how the crystal field splitting would occur in different types of these complexes. These questions may be very, very important for your CSIR net examinations. So we cannot ignore any kind of the complex, any kind of the geometry in which the crystal field splitting may occur. So in today's class, I am going to take these following complexes which I have given here, starting with that square planar complexes and going further. And last I'll end up with this, I'll end the lecture with this icosahedron, and there is a slight correction in this. Here I have written antiprism complexes or square antiprism complexes, both are same, right? So I'll not cover this particular one. So you can take the snapshot of this one. These are the following types of the geometry in which these actually crystal field splitting can occur, okay? Then you can see this particular one. First I am going to explain in the crystal field splitting in your say square planar complexes. So how I can form the square planar complexes, it's quite easy. Here what I have shown here, you can see this is the metal ion which is present in the center, and I have six ligands total, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and you can clearly see if this is the octahedral complex. Right now it is this is square planar geometry not having the six ligands, but you can assume if this is the octahedral complex, so what would be the difference between the geometry or the ligands or the coordination number? You can say you will have one ligand here and one ligand here, that would result in the octahedral geometry. So from that octahedral geometry I can obtain my square planar geometry. So what I have to do, you can imagine, if I have a ligand here in the octahedral complex, I am marking it as say this blue color, and again I have this ligand here. So to form the square planar complex from the octahedral complex, what I have to do, I have to remove these two ligands from this Z axis. So what I will do, I will slowly drag these ligands from the Z axis, and finally I will remove the ligands from the Z axis. So what will happen? It will result in the square planar geometry. Now you can assume there is nothing in this Z coordinate, okay? There is nothing in this Z coordinate, but you are having only four ligands in the XY plane, okay? So now you can clearly assume I have removed the ligands from the Z axis. That mean the metal d orbital, that mean the d orbitals which have the Z component in the orbitals, right, they will feel the very, very less repulsion. Why less repulsion? Because no ligands are approaching through the Z axis, obviously. So the energy of these Z orbitals would be very, very low during the crystal field splitting of the square planar complexes, right? While you can see here, this is my Y coordinate, so I am having one ligand here in the positive coordinate, and this is my another ligand in the negative coordinate of Y. So my Y coordinate is having two ligands. Similarly, my X coordinate is also having the two ligands. That mean my ligands are approaching through the XY coordinate. So obviously the orbitals, d orbitals which will have the XY component, they will feel more repulsions by the ligand, and that's why their energy would increase. On the other hand, because Z axis is not having any kind of the ligand, so their energy would decrease, okay? So here I have shown you this particular diagram. Say this is five degenerate d orbitals. This is the case of the free metal ion, right? And this is your famous barycenter. So you can write this as barycenter. This I have explained in my previous lectures also, okay? And then you can see what I have told you, the orbital which have the Z component would have the lower energy. So in this case you can see dyz, dzx and dz square, they are having the lower energy. Obviously they will have the lower energy because no orbitals are approaching through the Z axis. And you can see here, since the ligands are there in the XY coordinates or in the XY axis, so your XY, the orbitals containing the orbitals which have the XY component, they will have the higher energy, right? So this DXY is having higher energy while DX square dash Y square is having highest energy, right? So however, you can say why this splitting would occur, since all these having the Z component, and if all these having the Z component, then why the splitting is actually occurring here? Now, simple reason is that this actually, this Z orbital, it is having the X component, right? As well, it is all, as well as it is also having the Y component. See, this I have explained in my earlier lecture of coordination in chemistry, where I have explained the shapes of the D orbitals. And in that lecture, I have told you this dz square is actually made up of by the x component as well as the y component, right? Since this dz square is having x component as well as the y component, right? So obviously their energy would be high. On the other hand, see the, if you see this y dyz, so dyz is having only the y component. Similarly, this dzx is having only the x component, so their energy are actually less, and these two are degenerate. Degenerate means they are having the same energy, while this dz square is having the high energy due to this x and y component present in that. Okay, similarly, you can explain here, this is my dxy plane, right, which is having the lower energy, and dx square dash y square, actually these are, you can see this is actually the part of what? This is part of your EG. If you say the octahedral, this is EG part, dx square dash y square. And the lobe of this actually is directly on the axis. And since the ligands are approaching on the axis, so obviously its energy would be high. So we can clearly explain why this splitting is actually happening here. Okay. So this is how we can explain. Now moving to the say next slide. Okay. So here are the some very very important point which you always keep in mind. Square planar complexes, right? 4D and 5D metals, if 4D and 5D metal are involved in the formation of the complexes, right? And see, generally what happens when it is very important to note that whether in the square planar type of the geometry or any other kind of the geometry, whenever you will have the 4D or 5D metals involved, so that means the crystal field splitting would be very very high. Why the crystal field splitting very very high in this case of 4D and the 5D metals? Because their size are quite large and they are diffused, right? And the metals actually approaches very closely to the ligands approaches very closely to the metal center, and thus they do the very high splitting. So it is very important to note that. Okay, however, some 3D metals are also involved in the formation of the square planar complexes, but whenever you have the 3D metal involved in the formation of the complexes, then your ligands must be strong ligand, right? Say if you have the nickel as your metal, and nickel is having the coordination number 4, and with that coordination number 4, if strong ligands are there, then definitely your your complex would be square planar complexes. But in general, if you have the 3D metals involved and you have the weak ligands also, then in that case you will have your tetrahedral kind of the geometry. So here you can see some of the examples, right? Whenever you have this cobalt, nickel and copper, especially in these three cases, D7, D8 and D9 system. This system means the D orbitals having seven electrons, D orbitals having 8 electrons and so on. Whenever you have this cobalt, nickel and copper, and sorry for this actually capital O here, it is cobalt actually, it should be like that, capital C, small o, right? So this is your cobalt, right? If these metals are there, then you must have the strong ligand to form the square planar geometry. If these metals are there with the say weak ligands, then the geometry would be tetrahedral. Okay, then coming back to these here, so this is, sorry, this is not plus 2, it is plus 1. If silver 1 complex is there or gold 3 complexes are there, so they belongs to the 4D, and I already told you whenever you have the 4D and the 5D metals involved, in that case you will have the square planar geometry. In that case, if you want to calculate the crystal field splitting in the square planar complexes, then you will have this value, right? Time being, you can ignore this delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, right? So, however, you can see this one. Whenever your crystal field splitting in square planar complexes are there, and you have these metals, right? And in general, if you have, say, these metals involved, then you will have this value of 1.746 of delta O, and we'll calculate how this value actually is coming, right? So, but timing, you can note down whenever you have the 3D metals involved along with the strong ligands, and sometimes if you have these one, then you can have this value, okay? And in that case, you can see the value of this one. That means the square planar splitting is quite large when compared to the delta. It is actually, in fact, it is 1.746 times more than octahedral crystal field splitting. But you can see if you have this palladium complex, right, as well as your platinum complex, no matter what the ligand is, they belongs to the 5D series. Both are the 5D8 systems actually. In that case, your square planar splitting would have this particular value. So this is the difference which you should keep in mind, because you can see you may have the question based on this one. Whenever these metals are 3D metals are involved, or you see 4D metals are involved, then the value of this one, and whenever the 5D metals are involved, then the value of crystal field splitting in square planar complexes would be actually 1.3 times of the delta O, right? So you can see here what I have written. I have written delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, what they are actually, delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. So coming back to this particular slide, so what you can do, you can take this difference actually, right? You can take this difference, this you can report as delta 1. Similarly, you can take the difference between these two, you can take this as delta 2. And finally, the difference between these two, you can take it as delta 3. And when you have the numerical value of all these three, then you can sum all of them to get the total crystal field splitting in the square planar complexes, right? Actually, this is spectroscopic results. These results are obtained through the spectroscopic techniques, right? And here I have already written, though through the XY axis, the ligands are approaching, so they will have the higher energy. So when you have this kind of geometry, then DYZ and DZX would be your degenerate kind, which I have written here also. You can see here, DYZ, DZX, they are degenerate and they are having the same energy. After that, you are having your DZ square. So I have written this DZ square here, right? And then you are having DXY. So I have written DXY here. And finally, you are having dx square dash y square. So this is order just like that, right? But whenever you have the 5D metals involved, this is very important to note that whenever you have the 5D metal series involved, then obviously this dz would have the lower energy, right? This would come down. This dz would come down, and obviously this would go to the place of the this dz square. So the order would be just like that. Dz square is having the least energy, followed by your dyz, dzx, which would be degenerate after that, and then you can have your dxy and dx square dash y square like that, right? So this is actually spectroscopic results. However, there is no clear explanation why this is happening here, but you can assume in that case, whenever you have the 5D metals involved, then the splitting is actually quite large, and this quite large splitting is actually responsible for the alternation of these energy levels. Okay, so up to this point, there is no problem in that. Now moving to the next slide. Okay, here you can see what I have written here. Crystal field splitting in square planar complexes, delta SP, that would be equals to dx square dash y square minus dzx. So what I have written here, I can explain this one. If you take the difference between this one, right, dx square dash y square, and lastly you are having minus dzx, this one, because both are degenerate, so you can write or dyz. So this I have taken, this total difference actually I have taken, this total difference I have taken. So I have written here, you can see dx square dash y square minus dzx square, right? And this would be equal to sum of these delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, and I already told you this is delta 1. this difference is the delta 2. That means the difference between dx square dash xy, right? This difference is actually your delta 1. This I have written here, dx square dash y square minus dyz, right? Last one, right? So in that case, you can see this difference is actually what delta 1 is. This delta 1 is equals to 1.228 of delta O, right? Minus 0.228 of delta O, right? When this happens, so this value, see, 1.228 would cancel, and this 0.228, so you're left with only 1 of delta O. So instead of delta 1, you can write delta O. So I have written delta O here. Now you can calculate the value of the delta 2. So for delta 2, you know, you must take the difference between these dxy and dz square, which I have written here actually as delta 2. So if you take this difference, 0.228 of delta O plus 0.428 of delta O, if you solve this particular problem, if you add these two, then you will find it is actually somewhere around 0.66 of delta O. So instead of writing delta 2, you can write 0.66 of delta O, right? Clear? And then similarly, you can have this difference, this particular one, delta 3. So if you are calculating this delta 3, so this has given here 0.514 of delta O minus 0.428 delta O. And if you take this difference, right, then it is actually 0.086. So if you add all these values, delta O, 0.66 of delta O, and minus 0.086 of delta O, so this would come around 1.746 of delta O, right? And if you want to convert this, see, you know, delta O equals to 10 dq. So if you want to convert this delta O into the dq, so you will multiply that value with 10 to get this value 17.46. So whether you can write this delta sp equals to 17.46 of dq, or you can write 1.74 of delta O, so meaning is same in both the cases. So this is how we can calculate this energy. And see, in any textbook there is explanation is not there from where actually these energies are coming, but I have taken this from textbook actually. So to explain this one, why this value is coming just like that, right? This is the calculation. Okay, so I think up to this point there is no problem. Then okay, but in that case I can explain one very, very important concept. So this result I have summarized here. You can see delta sp is equals to 1.3 of delta O. This I have not given, but I have explained this particular one, delta sp equals to this one, right? So this is actually in case of some different ligands, which I have explained. You can see here your 5d metal cases, right? Or this value actually, you can see this particular one for 3d and 4d metal series. Okay, and the important thing is that why this high value of crystal field splitting energy is there for the square planar complexes. So guys, you can very quickly say that total number of the ligands are 4 in that case. Okay, and if you take the tetrahedral geometry TD, in that case also your ligands are 4. But you can see in the square planar complexes, crystal field splitting is pretty much high when compared to your crystal field splitting in the tetrahedral complexes, right? So guys, if you quickly recall what was the value of this crystal field splitting in case of your tetrahedral complexes, right? So that value was somewhere around plus 2 by 5 raised and minus 3 by 5 actually. See, it was just like that. If I remember correctly, that particular said delta T was equal to actually 4 by 9 of delta O, if you recall. Okay, this was the case actually, right? So this was the case in case the tetrahedral, but in case of the square planar complexes, we are having the much higher value. So why this happens, this square, see, generally what happens is square planar complexes are considered as the high energy complexes because they have very, very high crystal field splitting energy when compared to the octahedral as well as the tetrahedral field. So why this happens actually? The possible explanation is that, see, your ligands are approaching through xy and xy plane, right? So dxy and dzx orbitals are actually interacting. See, what actually I want to explain here. Okay, I'm coming back to this one. Okay, so you can see this is my xy plane. So whether you take this xy plane or this xy plane, so ligands actually, see, this in this plane two ligands are approaching, in this plane also two ligands are approaching. So you can see here dxy and dzx orbitals are interacting with only two ligands. So what happens, see, square planar complexes only two ligands are approaching, but in octahedral complexes four ligands were there, right? Because two ligands were coming from here and from here also, right? So in that case the ligands were actually the four, but in the square planar complex the ligands only two. So the explanation is that whenever the number of the ligands are little less, so they have the more chance to reach very close to the metal, and whenever the ligands reaches very close to the metal, obviously the crystal field splitting would be very very high. That's why in the square planar complexes crystal field splitting is higher than the octahedral. This is one possible explanation. See guys, you cannot actually compare this kind of splitting with the octahedral field, because in one of my earlier lecture I have already explained to you this crystal field splitting is directly proportional to the number of the ligands. Whenever the number of the ligands are high, then the crystal field splitting would very very high. But in that case you can see the crystal ligands, the number of ligands is 4 in that case square planar, and as well as in case of the tetrahedral. But this splitting is large because these ligands actually, when compared to the octahedral field, so they are actually reaching very close to the metal, and this causes the high splitting. This you should keep in mind. Actually it is very difficult, I actually find very difficult to know this particular fact, but somehow in the latest edition of selected topics in inorganic chemistry by Wahidul Malik, I find this explanation. So the reference is that selected topics in inorganic chemistry by Wahidul Malik, right? And see, generally what happens in that is, see what I have told you, in the these square planar complexes, since they have the very high splitting energy, that means they are the high energy complexes. When they have the high energy complexes, so the pairing energy is very very low. When the pairing energy is low, that means the electrons actually would have the tendency to pair up in the orbitals, because they prefer the say low energy processes. So since low pairing energy is low and electrons want to pair up in the d orbitals, so generally the square planar complexes are the low spin complexes. It is very very important to note that square planar complexes are actually your say low spin complexes. This is very important to note that. And these results I have summarized here, right? And now there is no problem. See, square planar splitting is greater than octahedral splitting, and octahedral splitting is greater than the tetrahedral splitting. And what is the relation? Square planar splitting, delta SP would be 1.3 or 1.7 of delta O, right? That would be equals to, that would be greater than of delta O, and this delta O would be 0.45. 0.45 means actually you are say 4 by 9, what I have shown here actually. This 4 by 9 will give you 0.45. So this very important relation you should always keep in mind. You may have the two marker question in the upcoming CSIR net examinations, okay? And in that case, I have already told you, whenever you have the 3D metals involved in the formation of the complexes with coordination number 4, so a strong ligand will result in the square planar complexes and weak ligand will result in the tetrahedral complexes, right? And similarly you can see these complexes here, right? So there is no problem in that. So what you can do, you can check the, see, I have given here systems D8 D7 D, these systems I have given here, and if you have these systems, then you can count total number of the electrons, and if you want to fill these electrons in the metal d orbital, so you can put these electron in these orbitals according to the energy level given here. Okay, say if you have the this particular one D3 system, so in the D3 system you will have one electron here, one electron here, and this is actually the high energy, so you will have one electron here because they prefer the pairing of the electrons in the d orbitals, right? Because pairing energy is low in case of the square planar complexes, right? So guys, this is the explanation for the square planar complexes. Now moving to the say next one, see crystal field splitting in your trigonal planar complexes. The second one is the trigonal planar complexes. So trigonal planar complexes, see whenever your complex is the planar type, that means z orbitals are not involved in that. That means z orbitals are not there. So when z orbitals are not there, so what you can do, say very quickly, say if this is the axis coming, that you can say this is say x axis, and then you will have your say this particular one, next axis is the y axis. Okay, so you can see z axis would be like that, just like that here. So z axis is not having any kind of the ligand since the structure is the planar, and when the structure is the planar, then we will always deal with the xy plane only, not the z plane. That mean whenever you have the trigonal planar complexes, this is the example of tetracyanocuprate one actually, right? So this is the example actually which I have written here. So coordination, see, first of all you have to think in this way, coordination number is 3, obviously the trigonal planar geometry would be there. Again you can see this AGI3, again this you can see coordination number is 3, so this geometry is there. So actually the ligands and metal are there in the xy plane. Okay, thus these orbitals which are present in the xy plane, they will feel the more repulsion, and during the splitting their energy would be very very high. So it's very easily you can see here dx square dash y square and dxy, they are having the high energy. Okay, why? Because ligands are there in the xy plane. And once again you can argue why this dz square is having higher energy when compared to the dyz dzx. Don't forget this dz square is having x component as well as the y components, right? That's why its energies are high, while dyz and dzx would have lower energy. So in that case you can see the crystal field splitting in the trigonal planar complexes. And I have given only two examples, but it's very easy to you if you know the coordination number, then obviously you will have the idea what kind of the complex it would be. So if you write the electronic configuration for this one, this would be actually 3d10 system. So whenever the 3d10 system, so all electrons, all these orbitals would be occupied one. And if you take this particular one, mercury one, so it is again 5d10 type of system. So both are the d10 system. First is 3d because this copper belongs to the 3d series and this mercury belongs to the 5d series, right? So if you want to fill the electrons, you can quickly give 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. In that case you can see here, so this is the case of the crystal field splitting. Very very important to note that. Okay, now moving to the next one. Now the crystal field is splitting in the trigonal bipyramidal, right? Trigonal bipyramidal, you know, see these are the equatorial bonds, this one and this one. See these red ones, actually they are the equatorial bond. Okay, and remaining, say if I want to give the color, these two ligands which are present in the z coordinate, they are the axial bond. So they are the axial, two axial bonds and three equatorials. See these things I have already explained in one of my lecture when I have explained the bent rule. Actually I have given all these details here about the types of the shapes. So guys, you can again very quickly realize what is happening actually here. So it's quite easy. This is your z axis. There is no problem in that. Okay, and say if you connect this by just like that, and similarly when you can see this particular one, this is another kind of thing, right? And then you are having this one. So what is happening here, almost all axes actually are getting the ligands, but you can see the orbitals of the this ZDZ square orbital actually are along the axis. This I have already told you. If you can recall here, this dx square dash y square as well as dz square, they are along the axis, and ligands are also approaching along the axis. So obviously the orbitals which have these x dash x square dash y square dz square, they will have the high energy when the crystal field splitting would occur in the trigonal bipyramidal type of the complexes, right? So this you can see here, this is the degenerate state 5d orbitals when the splitting would occur. So this dz square would have the highest energy. Why? Because the lobe of this dz square is actually situated along the oriented along the axis, and this dz square is also having the x component as well as the y component. Okay, so its energy would be quite high here. And there comes your dx square y square, fine. And then you will have your dxy, dxz and dyz kind of this orbital. So this is the splitting which you have to keep in mind. Okay, so if you want to take the examples of this one, so SnCl5 negative is the example, and it is your actually 4d10 system. When it is the 4d10 system, that mean all the electrons would be there. So it is very important to note that whenever the crystal field splitting would occur in the trigonal bipyramidal complexes, then your dz square would have the high, and dxz and dyz, they are the degenerate and they will have the lowest energy, right? Okay, now I am having my next geometry, and my next geometry is square pyramidal, but unfortunately I am not having the slide for this one. Okay, wait, what I can do, I can quickly explain what they are actually. So say this is your central metal I have written here, and you are having say this kind of arrangement. This is the square actually. Okay, I am not looking a very good square, so you can write ligand here, you can write ligand here, ligand here, ligand here. These two are actually towards me or towards the observer, these two are away from the observer. So this is the square planar. So if you put one ligand somewhere here, right at the top here, right, if you put just one ligand here where the tip of this pen is there, so if you put one ligand here and you can connect all of them, then you will find a square planar geometry. So in paper what I can do, I can write my ligand is here actually, it is again connected with this one, right? So again you can see the coordination number is 5. In square pyramidal kind of geometry, again the coordination number is 5. This is very important to note that. See why it is called the pyramidal geometry, you can assume in that way. These 4 ligands are in one plane and 5th is just like that, and you can connect all 4. So how I can connect these all 4 ligands, right? Very quickly you can see here, right? So you can connect this to this one, right? Similarly this to this one, then obviously you will find a pyramid kind of thing. That's why the name of the geometry is the square pyramidal. So whenever the crystal field splitting would occur in these type of the complexes, then what would happen, you can see here, see the splitting is just like that, dx square dash y square. See, however, I'm very very sorry for these small fonts. So you can say this is dx square dash y square, which is having the highest energy. So why these dx square dash y square is having the highest energy in case of the square pyramidal complexes? Because see, more ligands are approaching in the xy plane. Square pyramidal, see, you can see here, you can see here, this is the flat structure, which is this one, right? This is having actually the x plane as the y plane. Say this is the x coordinate, right? And similarly, this is the y coordinate. So xy plane is having higher number of the ligands. So whenever the XY plane is having the higher number of the ligands, obviously the orbitals which actually are there in this XY plane, they will feel the more repulsion, and during the splitting they will have the higher energy. That's why this dx square dash y square is having the highest energy. Okay, and then there comes your dz square. Again, you can argue why dz square, because ligands are not approaching to the from this z coordinate. Don't forget, again I am repeating this term again and again, z orbital is also having the x component and y component. So I am also giving the link in the description where you can see how this dz square orbital is formed by this xy component also, right? So these two you should remember. And after that you can see whenever you have dxy and dzx, they are having the same number of the ligands, right? Say dxy is having the two ligands, dzx is also having the two ligands. So if the ligands are same, so that means they will have the lower energy. And out of these, dzx and dyz, they are having the lowest energy, and dxy is having the intermediate energy. So more ligands in the xy plane, thus dxy orbital have the high energy during the splitting. Dxz dyz plane has the same number of the ligands, thus they have the degenerate one. This is very important to note that. See guys, why I am again and again I am explaining this particular term, this is a very important for explanation. See guys, you may have this kind of question, which is the more stabilized orbital in the square pyramidal complexes. So you will say dxz and dyz are actually the most stabilized or stable d orbital in the square pyramidal complexes when the crystal field splitting is occur. Similarly, if the question is like that, which is the most unstable d orbital in that square pyramidal geometry, then your answer should be like that. In fact, you see, this kind of question has been asked in the CSIR net December 2017 examination, wherein your some prismatic geometry you have to find the stabilized or the destabilized orbital. We'll see later in the slide somewhere I have written these things, right? And if you want to know how it actually this is happening, so you can go for the details in the textbook also. And the example you can see in that case is square pyramidal, coordination number is 5. Okay, whenever the coordination number is 5, you may have either square pyramidal geometry or you have trigonal bipyramidal geometry. So however, it is very difficult to identify by looking only this coordination number which actually the geometry would be there, right? But some few things which you have to learn. So if you see, this is the idiom, and you know your idiom is actually 4d. So it is 4d10. If you want to fill the electrons, so all electrons would fill in these orbitals, right? And then you can see the next one. Okay, now see, this is some different case, linear crystal field splitting in the linear complexes, right? So whenever you have the linear complexes, you know, you will have say one ligand here and one ligand here, and if they are like that, in the center you are having the middle. Okay, say this is the z coordinate, this is z positive, this is z negative, these are the coordinates. So what is happening, actually z coordinates are having the ligands. Whenever the z coordinate is having the ligand, then definitely the energy of the d orbital which are having the z actually component will have the higher energy during the splitting, right? While if you see this particular one, say if this is x axis, it is not having any electron and any ligand. Say this is y axis, it is not having any ligand. So obviously during splitting, your z orbital would be highly destabilized. That means they will have the highest energy. So I have given the splitting here. This is the again the degenerate state, the free metal ion state. This is the splitting in the linear geometry. So this dz square, so I am writing here, it is highly destabilized because ligands are there in the z axis. Okay, and then you will have the dxz, so I can write dxz and dyz, because they are having the z component, obviously they will have the high energy. And lowest in the energy, dxy and dx square dash y square. They are lowest in energy, okay, in that case. So you can see ligands are approaching through the z-axis, thus the ligands with z component will feel the more repulsion and will have the higher energy during the splitting, okay. And the example, you can see this gold example, gold complex. See, coordination number is 2, obviously the linear, and coordination number 2, obviously the linear one, okay. So what system they are actually, if you see this silver positive atomic number 80, okay, it is, okay, it is again 4d10 system. This is again the 4d10 system, and this gold complex, it belongs to the 5d metal series, so it is 5d10, okay. And you can calculate the total number of electrons to fill in these electrons. So all both the complexes are having the 10 electrons, so both would be all d orbitals would be occupied. So whatever the examples I have given so far, whether in this case or in the previous in the previous slides, most of the time I am having the d orbitals filled, that means the 10 electrons. So obviously the question would be like that: highly stabilized or highly destabilized orbitals present in the different different crystal field, right? So this is very important. This this, you know, it is the tolerance reagent, if you can recall this one. So this is actually the splitting in the linear complexes. Now moving to the next one. Okay, this is what crystal field splitting in the cubic complexes. Okay guys, there is no problem in that, in explaining this cubic complex. It is just like a tetrahedral complex, right? But in that case, in that cubic case, you will have a higher value of the crystal field splitting, right? Delta C I have written here. The C represents cubic complex, and it would be actually the twice of the delta T. And I already told you 4/9 of delta O is there for the C. I have already told you delta T equals to 4/9 of delta O, but delta C, right, this is equals to 2 of delta T. So you have to multiply this value by T. So this is delta O. So delta C, that means crystal field splitting in the cubic complexes would be more than your octahedral complexes by the factor of 8/9. In fact, it is more than your tetrahedral complexes, right? So how I can explain this particular one? See, this diagram I have taken, right, from somewhere. Actually, it is taken from the book by Burns. Actually, this is taken from the book by Burns. So in that case, you can see, if you can recall, whenever the crystal field splitting would occur in the tetrahedral geometry, then your T2 orbital is having the higher energy. So it is T2 orbital. That means dxy, dyz, dzx, which I have written here. Difficult to see, but you can imagine, right? This is dxy, dyz, and dzx. And E orbital is having the lower energy. That means dx square dash y square and dz square. Okay, this was the case of the tetrahedral splitting. But in case of the cubic complexes, this value actually is twice. However, the energy order of the energy of these d orbitals would remain same in the cubic complexes as well as in the tetrahedral complexes, but splitting is actually the twice of your tetrahedral complexes. This is again something very, very important to note that, okay. Then moving to the next one. Okay, this you can see here, the question actually has been asked in the CSIR net December 2017 examinations. In the trigonal prismatic geometry, which is the most stabilized d orbital? So you can see the d orbital, this dz square, not very clear, this dz square is having the lowest energy. It is most destabilized, and this question has been asked in the CSIR net December 2017 examination for 2 marks actually, right? However, there is no, because see, this prismatic geometry are not very easy to explain, but you can see why it is trigonal prism kind of geometry. You can see triangle is here, right? This is one triangle here, and if you see this particular one, this is the second triangle, right? So ligands, you can see 1 2 3 4 5 6. If 6 ligands are there and you are finding the unusual kind of the splitting other than the octahedral, then it would be your trigonal prismatic kind of the complexes. So the geometry is just like that metal, and this is actually coming out, this is also coming out, these four are in the plane actually. So you see, this is the ligand 1, this is the ligand 2, this is the ligand 3, this is the ligand 4. So these four ligands are in one plane, okay, while this fifth one, you can see it is coming out, it's a 3D geometry coming out, while this particular one, the sixth one, is it is also coming out. So if you connect all of them, then you will find, okay, a prism is actually forming here. So you can connect all of them just like that. So to have the better idea about these type of the complexes, you can Google it, right? So in web you will find the exact geometry, right? So why it is a trigonal prism, because four are in one plane, and the fifth and sixth are actually above the plane, so they are forming a prism kind of geometry, and the splitting is just like that, and already a question was there in the net examination, right? And the example is actually your transition metal. See, hexa-alkyl tungsten type of the complex. So I'm not going into the detail of this one, actually it is actually the organometallic type of the compound. I'll explain various kind of these examples when I'll explain when I'll start the organometallic chemistry, right? Okay, this was the question, most stable d orbital in trigonal prismatic geometry. So this actually 2017, which I have already explained, okay. And then you are having pentagonal bipyramidal. So if pentagonal bipyramidal is there, so obviously the coordination number would be 7 in that case. So how you can assume, this is the ligand number 1, this is the ligand number 2, this is the ligand number 3, this is the ligand number 4, this is the ligand number 5, they are in the one plane, they are present in the one plane, okay. Obviously the central metal would be like that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then remaining two, one would come out above the plane, just above this metal, right, just like that, and one would go down this metal, so it will again result a 3D kind of the geometry. So it is known as the pentagonal bipyramidal. Why? Because if you join all the lines from the top face or from the bottom face, right, then you will result a pyramidal kind of thing. So this I have given here, this is the central metal, this is the ligand, 5 ligands, this is the 6th ligand which is above the plane, and this is the 6th ligand above the plane, and 7th ligand it is below the plane, right? If you connect all of them, right, say if you connect these, this to this, this to this, right, similarly you can have this to this and this to this, just like that, similarly you can connect this to this, right, and this to this, similarly you can go this one, so it will result a complex geometry, right? However, it is not very important to know the geometries, right, but you should know the coordination number actually. So here the example is just like that, your zirconium F73 negative, ZR F73 negative, this is the complex which is there in this particular case, right? So this you should keep in mind, right, it is actually zirconium. Okay, this is ZR 4 positive, it is 4D2 system, if I correctly remember, it is 4D2 system. So if you want to fill the electrons, forget about this one, one electron would be here and another electron would be here, just like that, if this is the complex, okay, only one electron here, one electron here, and the splitting is just like that. Again, you can see the number of the ligands are quite high, and obviously the ligand has to approach through the Z coordinate. When the ligands would approach the Z coordinate, so Z orbital would feel the more repulsion, as well as the ligands which are actually oriented along the axis, they will feel the more repulsion. That's why it is having the highest energy. This is highly stabilized, dxyz, dyz, they are the actually the lower energy, but degenerate also. Similarly, these two also have the degenerate, Okay, so in that case, see, explanation is there actually. See, this is your x coordinate, it is having only one ligand, right? That's why it is having the lower energy. Clear? Similarly, you can see this dz square. See, ligand is there from z axis, ligand is there from the z axis, but you can see y is also having one ligand, x is also having one ligand, right? And z is having the two ligands. So obviously it will have the highest energy. However, a very clear explanation I couldn't find in any textbook, why the degeneracy is there and why the degeneracy is there, why the z component if having the orbitals, right? Sorry, if having the ligands, why they have the lowest energy. But the splitting is just like that. Okay, and then next is your crystal field splitting in the anti-prism complexes. So anti-prism, that means the two prism would form in the opposite direction, and more correctly it is square anti-prism. It is square anti-prism. So how square? See, this red color, I can form a square. One square is there, and again you see one square is here. So two squares are there actually, and when you connect all the ligands, so you will form a prismatic kind of thing. So the geometry is the square antiprism, right? So four ligands are approaching in this square, and four ligands are approaching from this in this square. So 4 plus 4, they will have 8, coordination number of 8. So it is very easy to remember, whenever you have the coordination number 8, then your geometry would be square antiprismic complex. Okay, so it is quite clear from the figure. Two equilateral, see, this is the equilateral triangle, and this is another equilateral triangle, and these are the two squares. If you connect them all, then you will find antiprism kind of the geometry. And splitting is just like that. Dxy and dyz having the highest energy. Since the ligands, the number of the ligands are quite high, it's not easy to explain this energy order, but it is just like that, which I have taken from some standard textbook. And if you draw, see, this is the complex geometry. If you draw the coordinates, then you will find the z-axis would not have any kind of the ligand. When the z-axis is not having any kind of the ligand, z orbital would have the lowest energy. So that's why it is highly stabilized, and these two are the highly unstabilized one, square antiprism case. And this you can see TAF8 3- is the example. And say guys, you may have another example also, say XEF8 2-, then you may have your rhenium complex F8-, right? So whenever the coordination number is 8, you will focus on this one, and this is the energy order. Fine. And finally, this is dodecahedron. When dodecahedron, again you can see in dodecahedron also, your coordination number is 8. So it is a little difficult to differentiate between antiprism square antiprism complexes and this one. But you can see here where I have to focus for this one. Okay, from this one, the part B actually, this particular one, this you have to focus, this highlighted part, this you have to focus. Okay, so this is again taken from the very standard textbook, that is Burns, right? So however, see, there was little confusion about the splitting of the d orbital in this complex. Some of the guys explained in the other way, and CSIR net also explained in the another way, but this standard textbook confirmed that the splitting would be just like that. And it is tetrahedral, see, in case of your tetrahedral geometry, right? So say from where, if I have start here, okay, say this particular one. This is actually the octahedral one, OH. Splitting is octahedral. See, O is there. This is splitting in the tetrahedral. And if you extend this value, so again like the cubic complexes, in the cube, all see, you have noticed already in the cubic complexes you were having the same crystal field splitting pattern as we have observed for the tetrahedral complexes. The only difference was that in the cubic complexes, the crystal field splitting in the cubic complexes was twice of delta t. But here actually you can see this dodecahedron. See, this is the dodecahedron, a very complex 3D kind of the geometry. Don't go for this, but keep in mind, whenever you have the cubic complex and whenever you have dodecahedron and tetrahedral, they have the same kind of the splitting. That means higher T2 set and lower E set, or T2G or EG, whatever you want to write, right? So in that case, it is also happening. However, the value is not that high that we have observed for the cubic complexes, but it is slightly greater than your tetrahedral field. So this is dodecahedron, right? And now moving, see, example is this one, molybdenum. See, octacyano molybdenate 4 is the ion. Okay, it is actually 4d2 system. It is 4d2 system if you want to fill the electrons. So the one electron each would be there for dx square dash y square and dz square orbitals. Okay, now moving to the next one. Okay, see, this is the end of the lecture. If we have the icosahedron, in the icosahedron there is no splitting. If you have the icosahedron type of the complexes, then there would be no splitting at all, because all the ligands would approach symmetrically. All ligands are repelled equally, right? Whenever they are repelled equally, so that means again, if you have the d orbitals like that, 1, 2, 3, and 5, and if they all repelled equally, so they will remain degenerate in the higher energy state. So there is no splitting actually. Right. So guys, this was actually this was your crystal field splitting in the various non-octahedral type of the complex. I hope you will like the lecture, right? And if you really like it, please share with your friends and subscribe the tetrahedron chemistry classes for the latest notification. Thank you very much.